So welcome to this session on elbow joint. Okay. Elbow joint is kind of homologous to the knee joint. Okay. In the introduction, you can say that it is homologous to the knee joint and it is formed by three bones. The radius, ulna and humerus. But we always start with the type of joint. Whenever we are describing the giant joint, what type of joint it is? It is a synovial joint of hinge variety. We use the word hinge for the hinges of the door. That means this joint is uniaxial. It's a uniaxial type of a joint. Okay, synovial joint of hinge variety, and then hinge joints are always uniaxial. So only two movements take place here, flexion and extension. While the movements of pronation and supination, which we were seeing appearing to be happening at elbow, but no, they happen below the elbow at joints called as radio ulnar joint, which are pivot variety. Okay. Now we next go to the articulating surface. The articulating surfaces have to be written. What forms the upper articulating surface and what forms the lower articulating surface. Okay. Upper articulating surface is formed by the lower end of the humerus, but not entirely. Not entirely. At the lower end of the humerus, there is a trochlear notch and then there is a capitulum. Okay, this is the trochlear notch and this is the capitulum. Okay, and this capitulum and trochlea, they are the ones at the upper end. So, at the upper articulating surface will be formed by the trochlea and capitulum. But the lower one is formed by the trochlear notch of ulna and the head of the radius. So head of the radius is here like this. Okay. Head of the radius. Head of the radius. Head of radius. And here is the trochlear notch of ulna. Okay. The trochlear notch of ulna. So now this joint can be called as compound joint. It's a compound joint because more than two bones are there. Whenever a joint is formed by more than two bones, this joint is called as compound. The lower is formed by the trochlear notch of ulna. Okay. And the upper surface of the head of radius. So this is about articulating surface, upper and lower. In lower, there are two things you have to write. Lower, what is there medially and what is there laterally. Okay, so upper, that is superiorly. Then inferomedially is trochlear notch of alpha, ulna, inferolaterally is the head of the radius. Ligaments. Always the ligaments start with capsular ligament. About the capsule of the hinge joint, you have to remember two things, that the capsule always is thin anteriorly and posteriorly and is supported and thickened on laterally. So laterally it is thick. Rather laterally, it is so thick that it forms collateral ligaments. So there will be two collateral ligaments. If you are looking from the front, there will be one ligament running from this side and one ligament from this side. There will be strong ligaments on the lateral side. These are called as collateral ligaments. Now let's talk about the capsule. So sometimes in the exam, they will tell you to show you, give you a chalk and the humerus and tell you that mark the capsule. So the capsule is formed in such a way actually that here above the trochlea, there is a fossa called as coronoid fossa, and here there is a fossa called as radial. Okay, so the capsule is attached in such a way. The capsule is attached in such a way that the epicondyles are excluded. Epicondyles are excluded. The capsule, the superior attachment, is attached to the lower end of the humerus in such a way that is attached to the lower end of humerus in such a way that the capitulum, radial fossa, trochlea, coronoid fossa. Trochlea, coronoid fossa are included in the capsule, and epicondyles, the medial epicondyle and the lateral epicondyle, the ends of lower ends of the humerus, at the ends it is called as epicondyle. The epicondyles are excluded. Okay. Then two, there is anterior ligament, and three, there is posterior. What is anterior ligament and posterior ligament? Like for example, if this is the lower end of the humerus, here is ulna, here is radius. Okay. So the anterior ligament are the fibers which are of the capsule running like this from the lower end of the humerus to the radius and ulna. Similar, there will be posterior ligament. Okay. But the main ligament now we are talking about, the ulnar collateral ligament. Ulnar collateral. Now you are looking from the side at the humerus. Okay, this is the lower end, the trochlea. Okay, and this trochlea lies in the trochlear notch of ulna. So ulna, the trochlear notch of ulna is like, okay. So then there is this ligament, which ligaments have to be shown in green, which runs from the epicondyle. It runs from the epicondyle. And there is an anterior band. There is a posterior band. So this is the epicondyle, the medial epicondyle. Medial epicondyle. From there, the anterior band runs. Okay. Then there is a posterior band also runs. And then they are joined. The anterior. The intermediate band. So we were discussing the ulnar collateral ligament. It is a triangular shaped ligament. And the apex of the triangle is attached to the medial epicondyle. And then there is an anterior band which goes to the coronoid process. This part of the ulna is called as coronoid process. This part which goes above is called as olecranon process. So anterior band goes from medial epicondyle to coronoid process. Okay. Posterior band goes from medial epicondyle to olecranon process. Okay. And then there is an intermediate band which connects the two bands. Okay. behind the medial epicondyle here will be the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve is there behind the medial epicondyle. Sometimes, you know, our elbow accidentally touches, or elbow accidentally touches some wood or something, and then we get a current in our hand. That is because the ulnar nerve is there behind the medial epicondyle. Medial epicondyle here. Okay, it is here. Now we'll talk about the next ligament, and that the name of that ligament is the radial collateral ligament. The radial collateral ligament, how it is slightly different from others. Let's discuss this. Now, ulnar collateral ligament is attached to ulna, and here is the lateral epicondyle, and here is the head of the radius. Now, head of the radius is actually covered by a ligament. Already it is covered by a ligament which is running from ulna. It is coming from ulna and going back like this. So there, the head of the radius is attached to ulna head by a ligament called as annular collateral ligament. And this ligament is like a band. It is not attached to the radius. It just circularly holds the radius closer to ulna. Annular means going around, annular ligament. Okay. Why? Because in this moment of pronation, supination, what happens is the radius which is here, it actually moves over the ulna. Okay, so when I do pronation, the radius actually in this region moves over the ulna. That means the radius has to be kept free. Therefore, there is an annular ligament, and the radius inside the annular ligament, it rotates. It rotates inside the annular ligament. Okay. And then there is radial collateral ligament. The radial collateral ligament is, it runs from the tip of the lateral epicondyle. It runs from the tip of the lateral epicondyle to the annular ligament. It is not attached to the radius. So whether it is capsule of the elbow joint which is attached above to the to the humerus, and lower down it is attached to the ulna and to the radius. So even the capsule is not attached to the radius. It is attached to annular ligament. Okay, capsule, we have seen that superiorly how it is attached to the lower end of the humerus, and inferiorly this capsule is attached to ulna and not to the radius but to annular ligament. That means the radius has to be kept free. The radius bone has to be kept free for the moment, and therefore it is kept free under the annular ligament. The capsule, the radial collateral ligament, all of them are attached to the annular ligament and not to the radius. Now let us check the relations. So what will be the relations of the elbow joint? When we talk about the relations, elbow joint, in front of the elbow joint is cubital fossa. So the structures present anteriorly will be the structures in the cubital fossa. And structures in the cubital fossa, all of us know that the structures in the cubital fossa are from medial to lateral side, median nerve, brachial artery, biceps brachii tendon, okay? And also then there will be brachialis muscle. Posteriorly, in the posterior compartment, there is only one huge muscle in the arm, and that is triceps. So that will be the posterior relation. What will be the medial relation? Ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve, I already said that ulnar nerve is behind the medial epicondyle. Now, from the medial epicondyle of the humerus, suppose this is the humerus lower end, and this is the medial epicondyle, and this is the lateral epicondyle. Okay. From the medial epicondyle, we saw the ulnar collateral ligament takes origin. From the lateral epicondyle, the radial collateral ligament. medial epicondyle also gives origin to what is called as common flexor origin. So all the flexors of the wrist, they take origin from here. Okay, common flexors. So we are not yet talked about their name, except for one name I'll be just taking here, that is flexor carpi ulnaris. It is on the ulnar side, flexor carpi ulnaris. So therefore, these muscle, common flexor muscles, they flex the wrist. They flex the wrist, they flex the finger. So if those people who are playing golf, they hold the golf stick always in this position. And therefore, they get develop inflammation along the common flexor origin, which is on the medial epicondyle. This is lateral epicondyle. This is medial epicondyle. So get inflammation, and that is called as golfer's elbow. Why golfer's elbow? Because common flexor origin is from medial epicondyle. So golfers will get pain. They'll get pain here on the medial epicondyle. Why? Because all the flexor muscles, common flexors, which cause this action, they take origin from there. So they hold the hand constantly, the golf stick, in this position. While this lateral epicondyle gives origin to the common extensors. All the extensors of the elbow. Okay. So this can cause inflammation in this area. Causes tennis elbow. This inflammation in this area causes golfer's elbow. Okay. And this area, it causes tennis elbow. So those who extensors take origin from the lateral epicondyle. So those who hold the racket, the cricket bat, in extended position, so they get the what is called as tennis elbow. Okay. So what is there laterally? Supinator, common extensors. Okay. And extensor carpi radialis brevis. What is the blood supply? The blood supply is from anastomosis around the elbow joint. This anastomosis is formed by the branches of brachial artery, branches of the collaterals arising from the ulnar artery, from the common introcious artery. Okay, some from the radial artery. So all these arteries, they give the radial collateral, ulnar collateral, introcious collateral. So all these collaterals coming from brachial above and these arteries below, they form an anastomosis around the elbow joint. Now, nerve supply is very easy to remember. It includes all possible important nerves in the upper limb. Median nerve, radial nerve, ulnar nerve, and musculocutaneous nerve. These are the four important nerves, except axillary. Okay, the axillary is the fifth important nerve in the upper limb. So radial, median nerve, radial nerve, ulnar nerve, and musculocutaneous nerve. Okay. Now the movements. Movements are only two: flexion and extension. Okay. So whenever we write the movement, we write flexion, we write the axis. Axis is transverse. See, the flexion and extension. Flexion and extension. They are taking around a transverse axis. If you imagine an axis passing like this and coming out of here like this. So transverse axis. So around a transverse axis, the flexion and extension. All the movements are described in anatomical position. That is a standing position with hands by the side, vision in the front, palms facing forwards. Okay. So the movements, the axis is transverse axis. Axis is transverse, and the muscles causing Axis is transverse. And the muscles causing flexion are brachialis, biceps brachii, and brachioradialis. And then our next action is extension. Axis again is transverse. And extension is caused by triceps. And one more muscle, which name you are hearing for the first time, anconius. So your flexion, we know flexion is by caused by the nerves of muscles of the anterior compartment of arm, right? Brachialis and brachialis and biceps brachii. Okay, brachialis and biceps brachii, also brachioradialis. Extension by triceps and anconius. Triceps and anconius. Now, there is a concept of carrying angle. Carrying angle. What is carrying angle? If you see a person standing like this and his upper limb, and up to the arm it is like this, and from the elbow the hand is slightly deviated. I have shown little excess, but hands are slightly deviated like this. This is carrying angle. Okay, so if you see our hand, this is the arm, and forearm is slightly like this, slightly. So forearm, this is carrying angle because the trochlea is slightly longer. And this carrying angle is more in females. Okay, is more in females because the pelvis of the females is wider. Okay, so this trochlea, the medial flange of the trochlea is deeper than the lateral flange, and that causes the carrying angle. Why this carrying angle is there? Because we have this carrying angle. If you also stand in front of the mirror, extend your hands, and you will see that there is slight carrying angle. This is not 180. This is 163 degrees. So not this, 163 degrees. Okay, the carrying angle. Females, it is slightly wide. So why it is there? So that we can carry objects. So whenever we are carrying objects from the market, anything we are getting, we are carrying something, suitcase in the hand, our hands don't hit the pelvis, okay, because of the carrying angle. Now the last component, and that is clinical anatomy. One, dislocation of the radial head. This is the radial head may get dislocated from the annular ligament because it is not attached. Why it is not attached? Because the radial head inside, it moves. It moves like this during pronation, supination. But in the small children, sometimes, you know, if we pull their hand very violently, this can cause dislocation of the radius from the annular ligament. So, pulled elbow first. Second, tennis elbow. What is tennis elbow? It is the tenderness over lateral epicondyle. Tenderness over lateral epicondyle. Okay, then there is golfer's elbow. Tenderness over medial epicondyle. The medial epicondyle, it becomes tender. Then there is student's elbow. So pulled elbow, tennis elbow, and student's elbow. What is student's elbow? Because the students, there is a bursa over here to prevent the friction. So students always keep sitting with their elbows on the bench. So this is also called a student's elbow or minor's elbow. Okay. Then the elbow joint can get distended because of some effusion on the posterior aspect. That is called as the distension of elbow. So there is inflammation. That inflammation, the effusion is there on the posterior aspect. So main thing is this the subluxation of the head of the radius. Okay, this happens mostly in the children. So that's about the applied anatomy part of the elbow joint. So again, we'll have a very fast revision of the elbow joint. Today we started elbow joint by saying that it is formed by the three bones type of joint. It is a synovial joint of hinge variety. Now today we added two more words. It is a uniaxial joint. So whenever you will be writing shoulder joint, you have to mention that it is a multiaxial joint. Okay, then it's a compound joint because more than two bones are involved. The upper articular processes are formed by the trochlea and then coronoid fossa and then capitulum and the radial fossa. Lower, it is formed by trochlear notch of ulna and upper surface of head of radius. Upper surface of head of radius and trochlear notch of ulna. Ligaments, firstly, capsular ligament. It is thin anteriorly and posteriorly, and there are thick ligaments laterally. Superiorly, this ligament is attached at the lower end of the humerus in such a way that the epicondyles are excluded and trochlea, capitulum, coronoid fossa, radial fossa are included. Inferiorly, it is attached to the ulna and not to the radius but to the annular ligament. Then there is anterior ligament, just fibers running anteriorly of the capsule, posterior ligament. Then is ulnar collateral ligament. Ulnar collateral ligament starts from medial epicondyle. From there it runs to coronoid process of ulna. Posterior band runs from medial epicondyle to olecranon process of ulna. Ulna, when you look from the side, is like this. This is called as coronoid process. This is called as olecranon process. And here is humerus. And this is the medial epicondyle. So anterior band runs from medial epicondyle to coronoid process. Posterior band runs from medial epicondyle to olecranon process. Intermediate band connects the two. Okay. Then there is radial collateral ligament. Starts from lateral epicondyle. From two radius? No, not two radius. Two annular ligament. This annular ligament is the ligament of the superior radioulnar joint. Okay. Then we talked about the relations. Anteriorly is median nerve, brachial artery, biceps brachii, and brachial is posteriorly is triceps. Medial is ulnar nerve, common flexor origin. That also we studied in the humerus. Medial end is common flexor origin, lateral is common extensor origin. Blood supply is by the anastomosis round the elbow, which is formed by brachial artery, ulnar artery, common interosseous artery, and radial artery. Nerves, all nerves, median nerve, radial nerve, ulnar nerve, musculocutaneous nerve. Today we learned how to write movements, axis and muscles producing the movement. Axis of flexion is transverse, muscles producing the movement is brachialis, biceps brachii, brachioradialis. Extension, axis is transverse and muscles are triceps and anconeus. Then we talked about the carrying angle. The medial flange of the trochlea is slightly deeper than the lateral, and therefore our hand is not exactly straight at the elbow, but it is going laterally. That is the carrying angle. This is to facilitate carrying objects in the hand, and it is wider in females. It is more in females, carrying angle, because the pelvis is wider. Why pelvis is wider? For childbirth purpose. A female is supposed to give birth to a child, and that is why the pelvis in the females is always wider, because the child head has to come out of the pelvis, and because pelvis is wide, the carrying angle is also wide. Okay. Clinical anatomy, we talked about pulled elbow, where the elbow, if we pull the elbow of a small child, the head of the radius may dislocate. It may dislocate from the annular ligament. Tennis elbow, tenderness over the lateral epicondyle, especially seen in people who play tennis and cricket. Golfer's elbow, inflammation of the medial epicondyle at the common flexor region. Student's elbow, minor's elbow, is the inflammation of the bursa, which is there on the olecranon. And distension of the elbow happens posteriorly. So it is done by aspiring the fluid from posterior direction. So that's all about today's session on elbow joint. Thank you so much.